齊。
Members, we have formed the quorum and it's the appointed time. Let's call the meeting to order. Let me see. This is the third meeting of the panel on commerce and industry. So item one, the minutes of meeting have been circulated to members and the secretariat has not received any proposed amendments. So can we confirm the minutes of the meeting, please? Yes. Okay, confirmed. Information paper issued since the last meeting. There is this information paper on the 20th plenary of the Hong Kong Guangdong Cooperation Joint Conference, paper number CB(1351)-1718(01). So if you have further inquiries on this paper, please raise them with the secretariat. Item 3, date of next meeting and items for discussion. The regular meeting in January will be held on the 16th of January, again a Tuesday. There will be 3 items to be discussed, including proposal for an enhanced tax deduction for R&D expenses. And that is item 1 in the list of outstanding items, and that has to do with legislative amendment. And that is also mentioned in the policy address. Second item. Progress of the establishment of the Innovation and Technology Venture Fund, item 2 on the list of outstanding items. And this is also a legislative amendment. Third item is development of Lok Ma Chau Loop Advanced Works and Main Works Package 1. This is a financial proposal and also a works proposal. We believe that members may have a lot of opinions on these 3 items, so we suggest that the meeting time be extended for half an hour, and that is it will run from 2:30 p.m. to 5 p.m. Members, any views and questions? If not, then we will confirm these 3 items to be discussed at the meeting on the 16th of January from 2:30 to 5 p.m. And in item 5 of the list of outstanding issues, that is on the development plan for a city cluster in the Guangdong, Hong Kong, Macau Bay area. The secretary has relayed our views at a joint meeting be held together with the EDP and the FAP. And the chairman of these 2 panels said that they do not object to this proposal, but then since the FAP and the EDP have proposed a duty visit to the Bay Area. So they are suggesting that the joint meeting will be held only after the duty visit. So members, please note that in the last meeting, in the last session, a member has suggested that we should conduct a duty visit to the Bay Area, and in the meeting on the October this year, a similar proposal was raised by a member. But we understand that the EDP and the FAP are planning to have a joint duty visit to the Bay Area to understand about the development plan and the latest development there. So I would like to ask members here, well, since this is the case, the proposed duty visit of this panel to the Bay Area should be actually combined with those or that of the EDP-FAP. So are you agreeable to that idea? Yes. So in that case, we will join this duty visit proposed by the 2 other panels. So that will be a joint duty visit of the 3 panels to the Bay Area so that we can understand the latest development there. So I hope that the secretary can notify the 2 other panels that this is our proposal. And also, please send a circular to members. To ask them to raise suggestions on how the visit should be like to us. So that's the secretary will send a circular to members and please come up with proposals, so that when we take forward the matter together with the two other panels, we can have more information to discuss with them, and we can have a better itinerary. And after that duty visit, then we will hold a joint meeting on the development plan for a city cluster in the Bay Area. So that will be this joint meeting of the three panels to explore into the relevant matters, and maybe we can make some observations after the visit as well. So this is, so when you receive the circular from the secretariat, please respond. So I'll hand over the work to the to clerk. All right, item four. One of the two main items to be discussed, free trade agreement between Hong Kong and the Association of Southeast Asian Nations. So can I now invite the administration team to join us? The papers have been circulated to members, and by the, well, at the end of 2017, Hong Kong has signed a free trade agreement and investment agreement with ASEAN, and the government would like to share with us the importance of the two agreements and the content of the two agreements. So can I now invite the Secretary, Mr. Edward Yao, to take us through the paper by the use of a PowerPoint presentation. The government has submitted two papers. One is LC paper number CB1340/1718/03, that is by the administration, and the Secretariat has prepared a paper, CB1340/1718/04. So please refer to these two papers. So now I'd like to invite Mr. Edward Yao to take us through the paper. And then I'll open the floor to questions by members. Thank you, Chairman, and thank you, members, for giving us this opportunity. I know that you are anxious to ask questions. Maybe Chairman, please allow some time for my colleague to go through the agreement with you, because this is a rather detailed and complicated document, and 10 countries are involved, and they are important trade partners, and the agreement comprises over 4,000 pages. There are four major areas. So can I get, well, will 50 minutes work for you? Yes, 50 minutes, please. Thank you. So our colleague has been briefing the various sectors in the Chambers of Commerce, and I would like to do the same to the Legislative Council. Now, we have had negotiations with the ASEAN countries, the 10 nations, for over 3 years, and this is a very, very important document for us. Now, in the past 10 years, ASEAN has become the second trade partner for us and fourth service partner to Hong Kong. Second, when we, well, this will be an important milestone going forward in signing future FTA agreements with other countries. For these 10 nations, or the, for the AMS, for 10 AMs, this is no easy task for us in terms of the complexity and the time taken to conclude the agreement. People have said that since Hong Kong is a free port, so it seems that we don't have to sign FTA with other nations, and these other nations can enter the Hong Kong market. But then there are important points in the FTA, in particularly in the service sector, and it goes to show that ASEAN has attached importance to Hong Kong in providing mutual benefits. There are four highlights. First, the FTA will provide a platform for us to reduce customs duties for trade in goods. Now, in 2016, ASEAN, we have to pay $570 million in customs duties to ASEAN nations. Now, second, trade in services. This is an important area. They are giving us national treatment. And in terms of the service mode, limitations on manpower and also capital, etc., the restrictions will be removed. And we can enhance our presence in those markets because of this agreement. Now, for these 10 nations, they are giving us more treatment more preferential than they are committed under the WTO. So they include professional services, business services, telecommunications, education, finance, tourism, arbitration, etc. So this is very important to us in terms of Hong Kong's mapping out its own strategic position. The third area is entry, especially for trade in services. Usually our people have to go there to provide the service. So in terms of their allowance for our business people to business visits to stay there, there has been relaxation. And the last area is about investment protection. We signed two agreements. One is FTA, the other is investment agreement. Through these two agreements, Hong Kong businessmen can be given equal treatment as their local counterparts in these places. So this provides great protection to investment and to Hong Kong businessmen. So this is a forward-looking and useful document for Hong Kong. And we hope that the agreement will bring a lot of business opportunities to various sectors of Hong Kong. So can I now invite the Director General of Trade and Industry to take us through the details? Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, members. This is a free trade agreement signed between Hong Kong and ASEAN. And we have signed a similar agreement, say, with other nations. And this is the sixth FTA we have signed. We signed one with mainland in 2003. According to Article 151 of the Basic Law, Hong Kong can, under the name of SAOG, signed various trade and finance agreements with other nations. So this is provides legal backing for us to sign such agreements. As pointed out by the Secretary, the ASEAN in the past two decades has become our major partner. In 1996, it is the fifth trade partner of Hong Kong. And in 20 years' time, it has risen up to the second place. And it has surpassed the EU in its ranking. And that means that we have a close trade relationship with ASEAN nations. It also goes to show that there is a much closer collaboration in the among the different economies in Asia. Among the 10 economic entities in ASEAN, four, including Singapore, Thailand, Vietnam, and Malaysia, rank among the 10 top trade partners of Hong Kong. And that I refer to the trade in goods. And overall, ASEAN is the fourth trade partner in trade in goods in Hong Kong. In 2016, seven out of the 10 Asian nations are seeing a GDP growth of between 4% to 7%, and that is above the average globally. So if we signed agreement with FTA with ASEAN, that does good to everyone. And the ASEAN nations have great economic potentials. Well, we spent 3 years in our negotiations, so this is an achievement that we have made. Now, in terms of the scope of the agreement, it is very comprehensive. It includes trade in goods, trade in services, and as well as economic and technical cooperation agreement. There are 14 chapters in the agreement covering trade in goods and other relevant arrangements. For example, rules of origin, customs clearance procedures, and also there are other arrangements in relation to trade in services and other general principles. So for these 14 chapters, while they were compiled based on the relevant trade and rules as enshrined in the WTO agreements. Generally, there should be fair treatment and there should not be unnecessary trade barriers. And within these 14 chapters, there are also provisions in relation to the structure and also dispute resolutions, etc.
Guangdong.
Just now, the Secretary
mentioned, a big area of the agreement is the reduction of tariff in trade of goods and services. So after 3 years of negotiations, we have achieved a concrete tariff reduction schedule. Now, under the schedule, Hong Kong and Singapore have pledged that when the agreement takes effect, all tariff will be set at 0%. That is, the tariff will not be charged. The other remaining 9 ASEAN countries, 6 of them pledged that 50% or more of tariffs will be reduced to 0 in 3 years' time. So that is a very important development. So in these 6 countries, Brunei, Malaysia, Thailand, they have not less than 65% of tariff that will be reduced to 0 in 3 years. So that's a baseline. So above the baseline, Brunei, Thailand, they will reduce further. For example, Brunei, 76% of tariff will be set at 0 for Hong Kong goods. In the schedule, we include other economies. So overall speaking, in 14 years' time, 90% of tariff will be reduced and will reach, some of them will reach a level of 0. So specifically, some products, we have a lot of export, or it's important manufacturing product. If you look at the examples here, we have clothing and accessories, using Brunei as an example. In 3 years' time, the tariff will reduce to 0. And similarly, in watches and accessories, Thailand will reduce the tariff to 0. Toys and jewelry will take longer. In the Philippines, for example, in 10 years' time, they pledge that tariff will reduce to 0. In Laos, it will take 8 years. In electronic equipment, electrical equipment, we do have a lot of exports in these areas. Malaysia and the Philippines pledge that more than 90% of tariff for Hong Kong goods will reach a 0 tariff. Now, of course, you are familiar, to enjoy tariff reductions, the goods have to fulfill country of origin requirements. It has to be products manufactured in Hong Kong or ASEAN. So through our negotiations, we have preferential treatment of country of origin. So if the product, its raw materials, its direct or indirect manufacturing costs, if it comprises more than 40% of FOB, that will meet the country of origin requirement and can enjoy the tariff reduction. So the procedures are, you're very familiar. Trade Industry Bureau, or one of the 5 GATCO will sign a country of origin. So when you clear customs, you can benefit from the tariff reduction. At the same time, we will amend our commodities ordinance, and we will have the ASEAN agreement included in the schedule, so we can enjoy the country of origin benefits. So moving on to service trade, Hong Kong is an economy that focuses on services. We have a lot of competitiveness in services. In the ASEAN economy, the 10 countries are at different levels of economic development. So there's a big demand for Hong Kong services. So we can enter these markets on a very competitive basis. So under our agreement, we have provided large opportunities for entry, including professional services, commercial services, arbitration, finance, logistics, construction, tourism, telecoms, and so on. Hong Kong and the 10 ASEAN countries have made some legally binding pledges regarding entry of market. For individual countries, their pledges have surpassed their commitments with the WTO. Let me give you some examples. For example, Malaysia, in its urban planning or landscaping or maritime agents work, their pledges have exceeded WTO. Singapore testing and accreditation, Thailand in telecoms and arbitration. This will be very attractive to our arbitration services. Burma, they have concessions regarding actuarial work. So the entry of our market has been expanded to these countries. So when you enter a market, Hong Kong has a lax investment environment. We don't have any restrictions, but in the ASEAN economies, there are some requirements. So through this round of FTA negotiations, the investment restrictions have been reduced. For example, in Thailand, telecom services, originally they only pledged that a foreign investment could only have a shareholding of 49%. You couldn't be a majority shareholder, but under our new agreement, they have allowed the foreign ownership to expand to 70%. Similarly, in the Philippines, in finance and leasing, it has gone up from 40% to 50%. And a lot of industries in Vietnam, they allow for wholly owned foreign enterprises. Indonesia in construction, well, Malaysia, if there are mergers and acquisitions and takeovers, they now have some thresholds. It's 5 million ringgits, and under the agreement, it will double to 10 million ringgit. So 10 million ringgits, we don't need approval. So for our investors, this would be more attractive and convenient. In legal entities, in commercial forms, for example, in Malaysia, in tax services, aside from being a partner, they also allow for private practice. Another area on service trade versus goods. Well, we have to rely on staff to provide services. For commercial, for business tourists, they have a 90-day visa. Now, if we have industry internal intra-corporate transferees, they can have an extension of visas. Under the investment agreement, we also signed an investment agreement, and these are similar to our international agreements. We have some concrete safeguards. We have compensation according to agreed standard in case of expropriation. We have non-discriminatory treatment and so on. We also have an eco-tech arrangement, and the 10 ASEAN countries and Hong Kong are at different stages of economic development. We can learn from each other. So we want customs or SMEs, e-business. We expect that there are some projects involving economic and technical cooperation, so we can share experience. Well, let me now talk about the implementation. We do have arbitration mechanisms, mediation facilities. So under the agreement, we also have intra-government committee to enforce the agreements. So overall speaking, the benefits, as the Secretary said, it can provide better market entry, it provides more business opportunities, there's a reduction of tariff. We also have a national citizen treatment for our enterprises and staff. And as in the past, when we implement these, we will provide information. So everything is on the web. We have the agreement, it's textual agreement and so on. So let's circulate the PowerPoint. It has summarized the government paper. So I'll now open up the floor for colleagues. 4 minutes for Q&A. We have two agenda items, and I think a lot of us are interested. Mr. Dennis Kwok. I'll try to be brief. I want to ask about professional services. How will you utilize the opportunities under the agreement, and how do you increase professional services? How can we reach these countries? So what kind of preferential treatment will professional services receive? Well, just now I highlighted in ASEAN professional services. Just now we listed some industries. Originally, they might not allow professional staff. Whether it's in the percentage of share ownership or professionals, even when they enter the market, work visas, the length of work visas, or you're already working there, if you need to have intra-corporate transfers, this has been expanded under the agreement. So these are the market entry, but after the agreement has been signed, Mr. Kwok is asking about what other opportunities do we have. So using this agreement, we will do some promotion work in the coming year. We feel that we need to do some trade promotion. We will work with professional bodies, and we can do some promotion work. And third, in ASEAN, we will have the third ECO, the ETO, and I can have my colleague supplement. Well, under the agreement, we have some pledges, for example, professional services. Well, first of all, that's legally binding, so it's a very real, very concrete, that includes legal, construction, and other fields. So we have to rely on communication between staff. We have to, when the investment increases, we see a bigger demand for professional services. And we are willing to provide information to help everybody do matching or understand the business environment. So if the professional bodies are interested, we welcome them. Well, you talked about promotion for the legal industry, Hong Kong being an arbitration center or an international dispute resolution center, that's very important. You need to promote that. So I want to ask the government arbitration dispute resolution services, what concrete plans do you have? Thank you, Mr. Kwok. Regarding arbitration services, Thailand, they allow our arbitration services, and that is even more preferential than WTO conditions. Using Thailand as an example, Thailand is an important bilateral trade partner. As trade increases, they need more than just goods or services.
They need legal services, arbitration services as well. So if they give us a bigger market access opportunity, then the legal professionals in Hong Kong can provide service there in the form of, say, establishing a presence there or through Hong Kong get entry into the market or access into the market. In my reply earlier, I said that going forward, we would be visiting the 10 ASEAN nations, and maybe we should go on our trips together with the relevant professional services. In the ASEAN nations, normally they just count on Singapore when it comes to legal services. So through this FTA, we believe that we can provide very good opportunities for Hong Kong's professions. Mr. Odin Chow, I am not a member of the CIB, but I'd like to thank the chairman for allowing me to participate in the meeting because I've been concerned about the trade relationship between Hong Kong and ASEAN nations. And I'm very happy that the government has signed this FTA with ASEAN. I think it's an important step forward. I have several questions for the administration. First, I noticed that in your briefing on the agreement, you mentioned about investment in services. You said that they have relaxed the ceiling for investment. Sometimes we can, in some sectors, we can actually wholly own certain companies. In the past, if we went to other countries to invest, we have to set up joint ventures with local companies subject to certain, say, capital restrictions, etc. In this latest FTA, can these joint ventures be established in Hong Kong? And then Hong Kong companies can enter or the ASEAN nations then. So is there an opportunity for us to do so? Second point, I noticed that in the FTA, for some sectors, the reduction in the tariff is quite substantial. For example, Brunei, zero tariff can be achieved in 3 years. For other places, it may take 10 years. For these latter nations, maybe in face of changing circumstances in the future, can the tax, the tariff reduction be expedited? And also, since it is important that we collaborate with ASEAN nations, can the government come to the LegCo to update us regularly on whether there has been an increase in investment, increase in business, and also update us on the situation in the individual sectors? Can we have a regular update from the government, please? Three questions altogether. My colleague first. On Mr. Chow's three questions, can joint ventures in ASEAN establish joint ventures in Hong Kong as well? And the criteria for investment in Hong Kong are rather lenient. As long as you can get a business registration, you can establish a presence. But of course, there are some other extra requirements in certain sectors like the finance sector. But apart from that, we welcome investment of all kinds. No. Can I interrupt? We understand that we are very lenient or lax, but what about the other countries? Does it mean that the joint venture has to be registered locally? And can the joint ventures company registered in Hong Kong and then get back to their own countries? Is there an opportunity for, to do so? Well, it depends on the investment requirements of the different nations. As I said, well, for some nations, they would have a certain limit on the foreign equity ratio. And under this latest FTA, some restrictions have been relaxed. Now, in Malaysia, say for example, in certain parts of the country, only partnership were allowed, now limited companies allowed. So we have to look at the individual circumstances of the different nations. And overall, I would say that the environment is more relaxed. As for customs duty, you have to be succinct. Customs duty. Well, I think we are progressing very quickly in some countries. Three nations are progressing more slowly, relatively speaking. But in the days ahead, we can look at the situation to see if things can be speeded up. Thirdly, on collaboration, we do have a mechanism to work together with ASEAN, and we will definitely update you if there is any major incident. Will you come back regularly to Letgo? Well, if you are interested, we are more than happy to update you on the latest developments. Mr. Ronick Chan, thank you, Chairman. ASEAN is a very important partner for Hong Kong in terms of trade in goods and trade in services. I'm happy to see this FTA. I must declare an interest. The bank that I'm working in has a presence, has a business presence in ASEAN nations. Now, after the FTA has been signed, we must strive for more preferential treatment for Hong Kong companies. Now, Myanmar, the business sector told me that Myanmar has very little interaction with Hong Kong, because in the past, Hong Kong has been sanctioning Myanmar, towing the international trend. Now, after that sanction has been lifted, Myanmar has been trading mainly with Singapore, and Hong Kong hasn't taken any part in the trade. So does the Hong Kong government have any plan to resolve this problem? And that is to say, the Hong Kong businessmen can actually venture into the Myanmar market and do business there. And second, Myanmar, the AMS will provide more preferential treatment. Business visitors can stay for 90 days, and for ICT, they can stay for 2 years and extendable for another 2 years. And for Indonesia, in terms of their commitment for business visitors, they are doing it differently. Apart from the very, very senior manager, one or two Hong Kong persons can serve as the top management. All the other management positions have to be taken up by the locals. So does the government have plan to talk or negotiate with the Indonesian government so that Hong Kong businessmen can be treated more favorably in Indonesia before we will be seeing more Hong Kong people investing in Indonesia? Well, the members' questions reflect the fact that there is a difference in terms of the economic development among the 10 nations. Some are more open-eyed, more, others not so. Others have, and some have more relationship with Hong Kong, others not. And for some nations where their economy is not that vibrant, they are doing things that will protect their own interests, and so they are not opening up as much. But then, one thing is important. After the FTA has been signed, the market access laid down in the agreement is all statutory in nature, and that is to say that they would not do things arbitrarily, so that is a safeguard for our Hong Kong investors. And also we have an established mechanism, and if there is further room for enhancement, we will definitely do that. At least we now have a mechanism to do enhancement. Now, Mr. Chen talked about sanctions. Now, for example, there may be United Nations sanctions. These are of statutory nature, and we must abide by those sanctions. But apart from those, in a bilateral or multilateral agreement, then we will act in accordance with those agreements. Say, for example, the investment agreement gives us certainty. And it can tell us exactly how we will end up in that country. The member mentioned about Indonesia and Myanmar. As our trade with these countries grows, Hong Kong investors may gain more confidence in those countries, and as a result, these countries will also further open up. These two countries may not be giving Hong Kong the treatment as well as other countries, but at least they are doing giving us a similar treatment as they are doing for other countries. Mr. Frankie Yick, I have several questions for you, Secretary. China has signed agreement with ASEAN a long time ago, and Hong Kong was missed out back then. And we heard that later on in the future, Hong Kong will be included in any agreements that China signed with other nations. I wonder whether it is true. Now, we've signed this agreement, and in Annex 1, we see how the tax or a tariff will be reduced step by step. Is it similar to contained in the agreement signed by China and other and ASEAN as well? Third, have you made a projection of the extra trade volume consequently? Fourthly, there are the Secretary has talked about eco-tag, about customs clearance, etc. I would like to ask a question about the trade single window. The shipping industry went to Beijing 2 months ago and talked to the China customs authorities, and we covered that in our discussion, and we hope that after FTA has been signed, this trade single window can be further enhanced and Hong Kong can really serve as a transshipment hub in the maritime 21st Maritime Silk Road. At that time, the Chinese customs authorities told us that this is exactly what they're thinking about. Now, we've talked to the last time of government, and we said that you must talk to the Chinese customs because they have been moving very quickly. So we must link up our efforts together with theirs. Well, the trade single window is a separate issue. I don't think I can talk too much about it in 1 to 2 minutes' time. But anyway, we are pressing forward with that initiative. Well, sorry, can you give us a paper to give us an answer? Well, I'll see whether we have communicated with the electrical before. If appropriate, I will give supplementary information. Mr. Yick asked about whether the fact that China has signed FTA with ASEAN, does it mean that it's covered Hong Kong? No, that's not true. Under Article 151 of the Basic Law, Hong Kong can sign international trade agreements under the name of Hong Kong SAR. So that's the way forward. And the Chinese agreement with ASEAN is different from ours because the two scenarios differ. We are signing this agreement based on the needs of the Hong Kong's professions and sectors. Now, we covered, say, sectors which are more vibrant in Hong Kong in our agreement. So their agreement is different from ours. So that's why these free trade agreements are very important. Well, we must sign our own agreement while the mainland authorities are signing theirs. We see that there has been a rise in the trade volume between China and ASEAN nations after the agreement has been signed. So that's why we're doing the same. Now, do we have any projection in the increase in trade volume? What I can say is that when the customs duty has been cut, the cost is driven down. We can save some $500 million per year, and we now have more opportunities to, say, establish a company in the ASEAN nations. I can't give any exact figures on the projections, but I anticipate that there will be more room for us to do business there. Mr. Jeffrey Lam. Well, Hong Kong is very different from ASEAN nations in many respects. For example, our customs duties, we are free ports, and we tariff-free, and so on. Now, even without the agreement, we are granting them tariff exemption. Can the Hong Kong government try to strive for tariff reduction or tariff exemption with EU countries?
You said you will promote Hong Kong in the ASEAN countries. I think we only have two ETOs or three ETOs. In other words, not each ASEAN country has an ETO. So if you keep promoting, you'll be spending more time on planes than on land. So even if we don't have an ETO, we should have a representative office when you go to an ASEAN country. And if you have a business card that says Singapore ETO or another country's ETO, the people might feel that you're not sincere. So do you have any budget or staff constraint that you need to make an application? If so, do so quickly. Otherwise, the next time you come, you'll say you don't have staff and you can't implement your goals. So this is exactly why we signed the FTA. Of course, we want to bring down tariffs. You've seen the real work that was done. And Mr. Lam, you're correct. We cannot wish everybody who will sign with us. We have WTO and the countries are reducing tariffs. We also have to look at who has a closer trade relationship with us, and we need to reduce tariffs there. So in our work in FTAs will continue, and you see that this is an important step. Just now Mr. Lam asked how do we do down-to-earth work. We now have two offices, one in Jakarta, one in Singapore, and they divide the work in the 10 ASEAN countries. So they're not just serving the one country that they're based in. We are in initial contact with Thailand, and we hope to establish our third ETO. So if we have three offices in the ASEAN, for example, in the European Union, there's only two offices. They are, we have three in North America. So having three for ASEAN, so that is in line. Of course, ideally, we should have an office in each country. And sometimes they ask, why don't we have an office in that city? So I don't think we can do that for all the countries. But once we establish the third office, we will redivide the work. And I think the focus is the countries with good potential, we need more effort there. So if we have an office closer there, we can develop networks and so on. Of course, we also want to focus on professional services. But we cannot just rely on the Economic Trade Office. The TDC has offices around the world. The Tourism Bureau also has offices. Invest Hong Kong also has staff. So together with our visits, we hope to achieve our goals. Miss Dr. Jiang Aiwan. Well, these FTAs, we just want to reduce tariff barriers. It seems that we don't have barriers, but when we go out there, we run into obstacles. But we need to start somewhere. The FTAs have been ongoing for 10 plus years, and finally we have signed up. And I see that it takes a long time. In 12 years' time, we might still have a few percent of tariffs. So I think it has limited attraction. So after signing this FTA, where does Hong Kong have the largest advantage? Well, setting aside investment, let's say for the service industry in Hong Kong, give us some examples. Which service industries can develop in the ASEAN countries? And the FTA, you would like to see the free flow of goods and services? Well, there are some problems with the flow of human capital. You say that we have 90-day business visas, but tourists should fall within the free trade agreement. So a few days ago, I received an inquiry. They wanted to go to Malaysia for a vacation, but they were denied boarding the plane because their passport was about to expire in 6 months. So shouldn't that be relaxed a little bit? I'm also aware that when the Filipinos come to Hong Kong, it's still very restrictive. So they can only stay 2 weeks. Other areas they can stay 2-3 months, but we only allow 2 weeks of stay for Philippine nationals. Will that be relaxed further under the FTA? Well, Ms. Chang is correct. Hong Kong do not rely on bargaining with tariffs. In 20 years, we were still able to build the trade from the fifth place to second place. So it's based on Hong Kong's export competitiveness or our advantages as an entrepôt. Of course, it would be good if we could reduce tariffs. And we're trying to reduce the tariffs bit by bit. If not, our businessmen will suffer competitiveness. So Dr. Chan asked a good question, which industries will benefit? So aside from goods, there is a large potential for services. In the 4,000-page agreement, there are 9 major categories, and that would include the professional services, arbitration, education, financial services. So these are the strengths of Hong Kong and what ASEAN lacks. The last question was about FTA and border control are separate issues. If we cannot relax the visa, it cannot be done. We cannot alter that through the FTA. Mr. Yusirin, after the tariffs are reduced, the market will open up. They will have more interaction between Hong Kong and ASEAN. So ASEAN flights with Hong Kong will increase, as we don't have flights to Laos. So if that's the case, given our trade and commercial activity, can you assist these countries establish flights to Hong Kong? If they don't have enough flights, you can add flights. If they don't have a flight, can you establish a route? Because we know that the airport has a very tight landing schedule. So could secretary assist? We also heard about relaxing tourism and tourist related services. So the ASEAN countries, what are they interested in, and what kind of support can Hong Kong provide so that they can be enticed to invest in Hong Kong? Well, the FTA does not include airline or air route agreements. But when commerce increases, the passenger flow or cargo flow will increase. And whether flights can be opened up might be affected. But FTA does not include that. But I think they are related. I'll defer to my colleague to the second question regarding tourism. Thank you, Mr. Yu, for the question. Regarding tourism, the ASEAN countries do mention tourism, such as hotels, food and beverage, tourist agencies, or even tour guide services are mentioned. So a lot of ASEAN members, such as Malaysia, Philippines, Singapore, and Hong Kong, have made pledges. Cambodia, Laos have also pledged opening up the market. Some entities such as Malaysia, Philippines, Singapore, their pledges are of a higher level than the WTO agreements. So we would like to accelerate the exchange under the FTA. So if the industry can utilize the communication, can utilize the FTA, we would like to promote the development. Is there a government, entity that can help, that can assist? Well, as we said in the past, the TDC, the Tourism Bureau, the Tourism Board, they are doing this work. This provides a very good platform. It allows us to reach these markets. They work hand in hand. Mr. Zhong Guohuan, well, we support the SAR government in signing the FTA. So aside from FTA, we also have an investment safeguard agreement, investment protection agreement. About 3 years ago, manufacturer in Vietnam, they were looted by rioters, and Hong Kong factory owners asked for my help. I had to ask the security bureaus. The security bureau asked the Foreign Affairs Ministry, and they had to contact the Chinese embassy, and the Chinese embassy could take care of the Hong Kong businessmen. So it had a roundabout, it took a roundabout way. So if we run into riots, the SAR government can liaise directly with the government and safeguard businessmen. Other colleagues might not be aware of this, but I have a very deep impression I have a good recollection of that case. Well, I have a question about the country of origin. The CEO, for example, in textiles going to EU or US, they could use the OPE system. Could we use something similar for the ASEAN countries? Well, currently, under the FTA, the CEOs, they have to rely on the FOB, your manufacturing costs, and so on. 40% or more of the FOB that will allow for country of origin status. And if it's totally produced in the country, and if there's a switch in the HOS code, we consider that made in Hong Kong. So we do have these measures. You mentioned the OPS just now. We don't use that arrangement. but we can consider how to make it convenient. But for the country of origin in general, we just require 40% of it to be made in the country.
What about the value of the raw materials? Does it mean that if the value of raw materials reach to 40%, then we say that is from Hong Kong, right? Now let's go back to the earlier slide that we showed. Page 8. It's not just about the raw materials. It's about also direct labor costs, overheads, and other costs like transport costs, warehousing costs, and other profits and profits as well. So the 40% comprises many elements or components. So semi-processed goods would also be included, right? Yes, probably so. Now, when you calculate the value, does it mean that it is up to the importing country to make the calculation, or is it a calculation done by the Trade and Industry Department? As I shown on the slide, if Hong Kong goods have to be exported, they need a certificate of origin issued by the TID. So it has to be certified by the Hong Kong authorities, yes. Well, as long as it can be certified, the importing country can accept. So it will be up to us to say whether the goods can qualify. But we adopt a very lenient yardstick. When we talk about the cost of raw materials, the materials don't necessarily have to come from Hong Kong. Well, the materials from the 10 ASEAN nations can also be included. So under that arrangement, Hong Kong can benefit. Mr. Ma Fong Kwok, thank you, Chairman. We, of course, support the Hong Kong government signing FTA with the ASEAN nations. It will definitely help with promoting Hong Kong's economy. I would like to ask the government, have you done an exercise to assess that once this trade agreement is in place, how will it benefit Hong Kong in terms of the quantitative benefits? For example, will there be an increase in the investment amounts, both investment in Hong Kong and Hong Kong investment to the ASEAN nations? And what about the job opportunities? Will there be more people traveling back and forth between these two places? And what about the total economic, the trade volume, say in 2 to 3 years' time, how much would it drive up our trade? And as for customs duties, maybe the revenue will go down because of that. But because of the increase in trade volume, the total benefits to Hong Kong will increase. So do you have some quantitative figures to share with us? I would like to come up with those too, but it's very difficult to come up with those figures. With the gradual reduction in customs duties, then if the volume of trade doesn't remains a change, then we can definitely save on the tariff payment. But I don't think the savings will stop there, because Hong Kong goods will be more competitive, and then there will be more exports. Second, there will definitely be an increase in the service trade and service volume, but it's difficult to come up with an exact figure. For some service sectors, the market entry threshold may be very high. It's not the same as trading goods, whereby you can make exact calculations in the savings because of the trade or tariff reduction. But for some sectors, there used to be no market access. People are now deterred from entering the service sectors in ASEAN nations because of the high entry threshold. And Hong Kong businesses might not enter such a market now because of the present restrictions. But as the some trade and services barriers have been removed, then there will be greater potential for development. ASEAN is the second largest trade partner in trade in goods and the fourth largest partner in trade in services. That might be the difference, maybe because of the reasons I mentioned. And I believe that there will be further growth in trade in services under FTA. Now, what about incoming investment? For these 10 ASEAN nations, they may have a larger demand for our services in the future. And as a result, they would more likely come to Hong Kong to invest and use our services. As what some members mentioned, that as there will be investment, mutual protection in investment, many more companies would like to come to Hong Kong to use Hong Kong as a place for their bridgehead. So we hope that we will be seeing tremendous development opportunities in trade in goods and trade in services. I'm so sorry you don't have a, you can't follow up. You can only follow up in writing because of time constraint. We don't have a second round either, Dr. N. Zhang. Sorry about that, Mr. Peter Shaw. I'd like to thank Mr. Edward Yao and Ms. Yan for their hard efforts, because they've been flying to the ASEAN nations all the time and negotiated with them. And to the business sector as a whole is a good news. And in some places, we are seeing that there will be tariff reduction year after year, and Hong Kong's business and sector will see a lot more opportunities. For the ASEAN nations, they will be opening up their market to us. In Hong Kong, we have different chambers of commerce in different sectors. What measures will the government adopt to tell specifically what are the business opportunities arising for the different sectors? Will there be any workshops to be organized? What is the government's plan? And in paragraph 5, it is said that all these ASEAN nations are along the Belt and Road region. And you mentioned here in paragraph 5 that this FTA will help us forge closer ties and enhance Hong Kong's role as a trading investment hub. Where, how can that be done? So can I defer to the Director General about the briefing sessions that we held and the promotion we've conducted? We are very more than happy to talk directly and explain directly to the Chamber of Commerce the content of the FTA, because different chambers of commerce have their different foci. And since the end of November, we have hosted many talks, and we are also staging road shows. I would like to point out particularly that on our website, there is information on the commitments of individual member states of ASEAN to facilitate the business sectors to read or understand the commitments and the different sectors. We are also categorizing the different commitments under the different sectors. For example, cosmetics, food, and how is the customs duties reductions are going to be like. So this is very clear on our website. And I'm more than happy to conduct briefings for the different sectors. As for the liaison, we will have a liaison committee with the ASEAN nations. Mr. Peter Shu is right in pointing out that the ASEANs are also economies along the Belt and Road, and this is the first strategic point for us. It is a very big market for us, so we attach a lot of importance to it. So the FTA comprises two parts, of course, is a bilateral agreement between the two places. And also, it can serve as a good example, a precedent for us. And that is when we try to venture into the Belt and Road markets, then this will serve as a very good basis for us to forge similar agreements with other Belt and Road initiatives. Because under the FTA, there is a good investment protection, clear market access, and also clear customs duty reduction plan. So there is a certainty to all these. So when we signed the agreement, we said that we want to use this to convey a clear message to the Belt and Road regions that Hong Kong is willing to have similar cooperation with other Belt and Road regions. I have two questions for myself. The Secretary said that for ASEAN, apart from ETOs, we have the TDC, the Tourism Commission, etc., which have set up offices in Southeast Asia. Now, well, following the signing of the FTA, Secretary, will you be consolidating the works on the various fronts? So that, and then you come up with a KPI to assess the performance of your efforts so that all the different offices can work towards a common goal or a common set of KPIs. That would enhance the effectiveness of the different offices. Second point, on the country of origin rule, you said that there is this general rule as shown in your PowerPoint. Mr. Felix Chung has also asked this question. There is this formula on general rule, but I think there is a lot of it is very arbitrary here. There is this addition of profit in the formula. So can you give me a written reply on the exact components of these variables in the formula, what they mean actually, so that the sectors which will benefit from the FTA will know exactly how they can benefit from the rule of origin using this formula. Apart from the certificate of origin issued by the TID, you said that these certificate will also be issued by recognized certificate of origin issuers. So can you tell us exactly what these organizations are so that we not be subject to challenge by ASEAN nations in the future? Well, all these can be found in the agreement. We can provide a copy to you as to exactly the requirements on the cost and etc. Article 6 of the agreement lists all these out. As for the issuing organizations, apart from the TID, there are five chambers of commerce which are issuing certificates of origin. They have the relevant experience, the capability to issue certificates of origin. We are just following the established practice. We hope to help or provide more convenience for the sector. That is, they can make the application with the TID and also the Chambers of Commerce. On the point about rules of origin, we use a more flexible formula now. This is a formula which is more readily acceptable by all. Now, Mr. Felix Chung asked about where we can use OPA. We used to have OPA for garment, but because Hong Kong is very well connected to mainland, some of the processes are being done on the mainland. But say, for in the case of ASEAN nations, we would not, say, be using components from the ASEAN like what we do with the mainland. Mr. Wu, on your second point, I agree with that. There are different agencies working on this area. Now, following the signing of the FTA and the Belt and Road Policy, we do see there is a need to consolidate works on various fronts. That's why the CEDB is willing to take up this coordinating role on the Belt and Road Initiative, no matter is the Hong Kong Invest and the ETOs and etc. They are all under the ambit of the CEDB. Since we are trying to identify more business opportunities in the Belt and Road Initiative, we are more than happy to take up the coordinating role and do more work.
You can give us a written response regarding the CO question. And second, I'd like the secretary to come back at an appropriate time to tell us about the development of the different division of work of the ETOs. Well, the details are in the annex, so we might just give the references to the secretariat, and in our next meeting about the ETOs, I heard Chairman's comments, but I have nothing special to add right now. Well, after, we do have a lot of questions regarding the ASEAN FTA. And we do need written responses to some questions. And if the answers were not satisfactory in the Q&A, we would like written responses. So I think we'll have to end the discussion on this item. We now need to move on to the fifth item, and that is on the One Belt, One Road Initiative office, and the secretary is still going to be here with us. So Industry Commerce Bureau, they have proposed creation of a directorate post in the Belt and Road office, and they will be giving us a briefing on that. So, I'll hand, please note that the government has prepared a paper, CB1340-1718-05. We also have a paper from the Secretariat, it's CB1340-1718-06, so Secretary, and the pass. I had talked about our One Belt, One Road work in this panel. And this work has been taken up by the Commerce Economic Development Bureau. And I explained that the One Belt, One Road work is in line with the Commerce Economic Development Bureau's ambit. So we now have 100 countries who want to participate or have positive response to the OBR, One Belt, One Road initiative. They want to extend cooperation and so on. In the SAR, we see that Hong Kong can play a significant role. And as we talked about the ASEAN topic, Hong Kong has international finance, trade, and maritime status. And if the mainland wishes to go out or attract investment, we can play a role. And as we said in the previous session, our professional services we can play to our strengths, and that's why in the new term of government, last week our CE had met with the National Reform Committee. They had signed the document, and they raised 6 key areas, and these are the strengths of Hong Kong, including finance services. We are offshore renminbi center. We are a fundraising capital. We're also a finance center. And in light of green finance, we also have certain advantages. So this is our first strength in six areas. Second, we have strengths in infrastructure, maritime. We also have strengths in trade. So aside from these three areas, we also mentioned professional services. Mr. Dennis Kwok mentioned the financial dispute resolution or dispute resolution. We also have strengths in legal services. And the fourth area is people-to-people social networking. And under the Bay Area development, Hong Kong will need to play a positive role. Last week, we also had laid down some follow-up work. We will have a meeting with our counterparts, such as the NRC, National Reform Committee. We will meet with the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. We'll also meet with the Hong Kong Macau Liaison Office. And we have three major events next year, at the beginning of the year. We will meet with our mainland counterparts to promote the strengths of Hong Kong. We will also have the One Belt, One Road Summit. And third, and the next year, we will also take advantage of the tourist opportunities. We want Hong Kong to be one destination amongst the many destinations along the One Belt, One Road. So young entrepreneurs, entrepreneurs and so on will all be interested in our exchange programs. So the work ahead of us, that might be done within our team of Commerce and Economic Development Bureau, but there's also a lot of extra work. So we feel that in this term of government, we do need an extra pair of hands to deal with this workload. And since it's going to be a regular part of our workload, we also need to formalize the arrangements, and that's why we want to set up a One Belt, One Road office. It's not going to be independent. It will be a permanent office under Mr. Le Kwai Hong's leadership. They will also have to liaise with Invest Hong Kong, the ETOs. They also have to work with Trade and Industry. They also have to work with TDC, Invest Hong Kong, and so on. So we hope LegCo can support our overall direction, the specifics, and also support our manpower needs. And if necessary, we will make an application to LegCo. Okay, let's open it up to Q&A. Mr. Jimmy Im. Well, according to the paper, the One Belt, One Road office, it will be an information sharing platform, and I note that TDC already has a web portal. So I want to ask the government, can you explain this information portal and the TDC portal? What major differences are there? And what is the division of labor between the two bodies? Well, in our agreement with the mainland, we want to set up a portal. When we talk to the industries, they ask, what kind of business opportunities are there? Can you give us some project items? So aside from central government decided items, led by state-owned enterprises, some of them might be approved at the provincial municipal level. So through the arrangement, whether it's the provinces, municipalities, or SOEs, we want more information. And Mr. Ng is correct. The TDC has a portal. It lists some project items. For example, in September, in the September summit, there were 175 items listed. So if we get more information from the central government, from provincial, municipal, or SOEs, we can supplement the TDC information. So when TDC does matching, they can do a better job. So we can complement each other, there's no contradiction. Mr. Yu Siwen. Let me read out the list. Holden Chow, Chen Zhanying, Zhang Laiwan, Zhong Guokban, Dennis Kok, Siu Gafai, and myself. So I think 4 minutes, and we'll need an extra 15 minutes. So I'll draw the line there. 4 minutes, Mr. Yu Siwen. Regarding what OBOR, I support that. The whole world is talking about business opportunities under OBOR, but we heard a lot of talk, but it gives us the impression that it is remote, it's distant, it's intangible, whereas the Hong Kong, Macau, Greater Bay Area seems more tangible. So I wonder if this will we have more concrete indicators? So we need to have concrete performance goals. We also heard about specific projects, multiple destination or investment in hotels, transport, and so on. So the commissioner what can they do to help us achieve these goals? Mr. Yu is correct. OBOR and the Greater Bay Area are linked. We had made some cross-reference. It's not a matter of which comes first. So the Greater Bay Area has better development, and that will strengthen Hong Kong's position. And if we can utilize OBOR and attract long-distance travelers, then the Greater Bay Area will also benefit. We can use Hong Kong as a destination stop and radiate to the Greater Bay Area cities. It's not a matter of which comes first. It's mutual complementary. We do see professions and enterprises who have identified business opportunities. So we want these opportunities to, we want our businesses to find, to identify these opportunities. So the BRO KPI is not going to be how much business they can find in dollar terms, even in Invest Hong Kong. We look at whether different industries, whether they can be attracted. We don't give them a dollar figure goal. Of course, we do have some statistics indicating how many businesses were established in Hong Kong. So our staff in this system will ensure that Hong Kong will get the maximum business opportunities, and we will coordinate the efforts of different industries including professional services. We will maximize their business opportunities. And we would like to achieve synergies and help us achieve our goals. Will you assist in investment in the One Belt, One Road countries? Well, we will do the work mentioned by Mr. Yu. We will coordinate with the industry.
Mr. Houghton Chow, thank you, Chairman. My first question is asked on behalf of Mrs. Regina Yip, who is otherwise engaged. So yeah, she asked me to ask this first question. Mrs. Yip's question is that she noticed that for this three posts for the BRO, they will serve on a maximum 5 years. But the nation says that the Belt and Road Initiative should straddle across a few generations. So she's asking why you are setting up the post for 5 years instead of making them a permanent posts. So this is number one. Number two, this question is coming from myself. Commissioner, Deputy Commissioner, Assistant Commissioner of this office is being will be established or will be created. My view is that if we take forward the Belt and Road Initiative, we should focus on the countries with the greatest potential. We should not work on all countries in a similar way. There should be priorities to be set. So this is my first comment. And for the post to be created, how does the post compare with offices in the ETO in terms of their grace and seniority? Would that be overlapping of the work or positions? Now, I agree with Mr. Cho that we should be more focused because we're talking about over 100 countries, so we should set priorities. In the discussion on the last item on FTA, as what Mr. Houghton Chow said, those with trade potential with us, then we should focus on those. And maybe countries which have a strength in certain, which can connect with us in certain professions, say professional services, then we will work on those. And also for countries which can readily sign investment protection agreement with us, then we would work on those as well. So in the mainland mainland companies should understand about the strength of Hong Kong, so we will work on that in next year. In our overseas visits, we are discussing with the TDC to pinpoint the countries which we should reach out first, for example, those including those in the Middle East and Southeast Asia. We should adopt a strategic approach, and that ties in with what Mr. Ho Chow said. Now, for ETOs, they are working on the countries. They are there in the countries. But for the team, BRO, they will be stationed locally, and they would try to liaise with the relevant sectors, and they do coordination work. We would not just be relying on this team of few people, rather they would do coordination among the different sections under the CEDB. Permanent Secretary? In our proposal to create directorate posts for PBRO, we are proposing to establish three directorate posts, Commissioner, Deputy Commissioner, and Assistant Commissioner. And the Commissioner and the Deputy Commissioner are permanent posts without time limit. The third post, Assistant Commissioner, is proposed to be a AOSGC post, a supernumerary post lasting for 5 years. And after 5 years, we'll review the situation to see if that post is needed further. Mr. Ronick Chen. Thank you, Chairman. I have said on various occasions that the government should devote more resources for the Belt and Road Initiative. I fully support the document. In paragraph 11, it is said that the several posts will liaise or enter into dialogues with senior officials and have internal discussions. And the commissioner is at a D6 level, and it's senior enough for him to have dialogues with senior officials in other countries, and he has also have to take up the coordinating role in liaison with different bureaus. Have you talked to the other government policy bureaus, asking them to try to follow the instructions of this commissioner? And in paragraph E, of 4E, it says that the BRO will enhance the rapport between the government and business professional sectors. Does the government have planned, have a blueprint to help the banking sector to take, to be more active in the Belt and Road Initiative? And do you have a blueprint, and do you have a timeline, if you don't have a blueprint, as to when you would promulgate specific measures for the relevant sectors? In the finance sector, actually, last week when the CE signed the agreement with the central authorities, we issued a press release which has been uploaded on the website. In the six areas, well, one of the first area is finance and investment. We mentioned particularly that Hong Kong has is well placed to help the country in taking forward the Belt and Road Initiative when it comes to financing, finance sector, which covers, say, syndicated loans, financing, etc. Second, we said we support that the HKMA is setting up the FFO office. And thirdly, we talk about the green financing. We can be the international accreditation organization. And fourthly, we would be positioning Hong Kong as a renminbi settlement center. Fifth, we would be helping finance sectors and helping the, say, multilateral banks and organizations to set up a presence in Hong Kong. And six, we talk about collaboration between the government and social capital. So these are the six areas which are exactly the blueprint that the Mr. Ranuchet is referring to. We will continue our discussion on these six fronts with the relevant sectors. I hope that that can give confidence to Mr. Chen. We have to talk, of course, still further with the sector. This is what Hong Kong can do, clearly. Second question. The new term of government thinks that a Belt and Road Initiative is the work of the whole government, it's not just the work of a tiny office, a BRO. So that's why the CDB is tasked to spearhead the entire initiative, and the different sections in my bureau will work together to take forward the initiative. But in any case, we need a BRO to do the overall coordinating work. Now, as far as liaison with overseas, our overseas counterparts, is a D6 post holder senior enough? I think that's an appropriate level as far as the post is concerned. It's not he alone who is working on the initiative. I will be leading him as well. And also, in signing the FTA, actually, that was done by the direct an official at the director and deputy director grade. And is the work of the entire government, this Belt and Road Initiative, and CDB is spearheading it. Dr. N. Zhang. The BRO was established some time ago, you are now proposing the creation of three new directorate posts, three persons. So how many persons are there in total in this office? Chairman, in the last term of government, we already established the BRO. We have more or less a similar strength that we have now. We asked staff or civil servants who had just retired to fill up the post, but they have a wealth of experience, and we think that we should regularize the staff establishment. The last term, during the last term of government, there was no permanent directorate to posts. But those who fill the posts are actually were previously directorate staff. In terms of headcount, we are one person less than now than the establishment in the last term of government, following the departure of the former commissioner and deputy commissioner. Well, these posts will be reporting to the permanent secretary for commerce, industry and tourism. What about the ETOs? To whom are they reporting to now? Is it the PS? For the 12 ETOs, the heads of those ETOs. And they are under the commerce, industry and tourism branch, and the permanent secretary for that branch is myself. So in the future, the BRO and the ETOs will report to myself, and I myself will report to the secretary. So the ETOs in Beijing and Guangdong are also under Mr. Yong, right? Now, there is a difference here. Mr. Yong is looking after not just tourism, but also commerce and industry as well. For the 12 ETOs, they are under his portfolio. For the 5 ETOs on the mainland, because they are in the mainland, they fall under the portfolio of the CMAB, the Secretary for Constitutional and Mainland Affairs. But of course, the two policy bureaus have a lot of cooperation. But for the 5 mainland ETOs, they are under the CMAB. I do hope that you have sufficient manpower and you have experienced your staff to help you. We need people who are familiar with the situation in the Belt and Road regions to fill the posts. If you don't have enough manpower, please create more posts. This is a very long-term economic initiative. Thank you, Dr. Zhang. Mr. Felix Cheng, thank you, Chairman. Many people in the business sector believe that there are tremendous business opportunities in the Belt and Road Initiative, but they don't know where to start now. So the BRO is good because it can, you know, bring a lot more information to the business sector so they know where to start. But the region covers 66 nations. And the secretary said that they will focus on areas where there has been FTA signed and maybe countries in the Middle East. But still, the scope is still too wide. Can you focus on places to start with? The secretary said that the CE signed an agreement on Belt and Road Initiative in Beijing. We know that a lot of mainland enterprises do have the capital, but they don't have the capability to go global, so they have to work together with Hong Kong companies and Hong Kong's professional services. But for the BRO, can you do some matching exercises? And For the present PRO, the staff are ex-civil servants, retired civil servants. I mean, what work have they done already? Thank you, Mr. Chung, for your question. I agree. That when the Belt and Road Initiative is gaining popularity globally, and the scope is getting wider and wider. It covers more than 100 countries.
And when the UK officials were in Beijing, they had signed a lot of agreements. So, well, the work is not just handled by one office. We have to rely on TDC, we have to work with Commerce Economic Development Bureau, we liaise with the industry. We now have to expand the scope of our consultation. We work with 30 plus institutes, we cooperate with the TDC, and every year we need to develop a plan. Just our three major items in 2018, we have SOEs, because the initiative will be led by SOEs. We want to take part or cooperate. So one example would be the railway development and MTR are already in cooperation. If you look at TDC website, we have Hong Kong architects who are working in project management that's related to One Belt, One Road. Well, we need to focus on our successful examples. So in the three major items in 2018, they have a different focus. One faces the country, one faces the world, and one faces a specific industry such as tourism. So every year we want to identify these goals, and we have to communicate with the industry. Now, Mr. Zhong asked what specific work have we done. Well, we know that the work has been launched, and last year and middle of this year we had taken part in the Beijing summit conference. We had a team of 30 people. The office has established some basic work, and in the last few months, internationally, and the industry have different levels of interest. So with the new term of government, the work is now placed in Commerce and Economic Development Bureau. We have developed a new strategy and a roadmap. So through, we will... You can say it's a new chapter. The office had, the Belt and Road office has started the work, but we do have a long path ahead of us, and that's why we need LegCo's support. Mr. Kwang Hung, I want to follow up on legal services such as arbitration, mediation, dispute resolution services. What actual blueprint or work do you have in mind? I know you want to promote that, but it's already ongoing. Different government departments, the DOJ or even the Hong Kong International Arbitration Center are working on that, but that's not enough. What concrete work will you be undertaking to consolidate Hong Kong's role as an international arbitration center? That is one area of focus. If you look at the Belt and Road office document, mediation is one of the areas. Finance is one, trade and economics, but just dispute resolution is one item by itself. We can utilize Hong Kong's legal system, Hong Kong's advantage, and we support Hong Kong in building a Asia-Pacific dispute resolution center. That's a matter of positioning. We also want to be a center for the Asia-Pacific region. So aside from promoting our services, we need to our dispute resolution legal professionals need to work in the different jurisdictions, including ASEAN. Can we provide services overseas? So we need to find specific business opportunities. Our law firms, I know that they can set up partnerships in Guangdong. Can we extend further? And we can discuss with the industry, and we welcome Mr. Kwok's suggestions. Well, I'll give an example. The Hong Kong International Arbitration Center, if they arbitrate on the mainland, according to mainland law, that is not considered a formal arbitration because mainland laws do not acknowledge Hong Kong International Arbitration Center doing arbitration work on the mainland. Now, if the HKIAC can conduct arbitration on the mainland, that would be a breakthrough. Or if Hong Kong barristers, aside from providing legal counsel, they cannot do anything else on the mainland, that would be a breakthrough. So what can you do? So I want concrete responses for us to understand the function of this BRO. That is exactly what we need to discuss with the industry, and we need to reflect these to our counterparts. And as Mr. Kwok said, aside from obtaining mainland accreditation, can we be designated as a dispute resolution center? Can we utilize Hong Kong's legal framework? That can be done step by step, and I think there are a lot of details, and I'm willing to have to establish a platform for further follow-up. Mr. Xiu Gafai, the OBOR is a national policy, and Hong Kong will also benefit from business opportunities. So I think the work involved would be much larger than the previous item on ASEAN. And we talk about tariffs and legal systems. We'll need a lot of staff. So if this paper is calling for additional creation of a directorate post, and I support that. We want to do this as fast as possible. I have no questions. I just want to express my support. Mr. Ma Fung-go. Regarding OBOR office, a commissioner was appointed on a voluntary basis. So I think it's necessary that we have staff. I just don't understand at the time why did we have a voluntary chairman or a voluntary commissioner. So this commissioner post is vacant. So will we appoint the previous voluntary person to serve as commissioner? I also want to ask, participation in OBOR, our mainland counterparts will also, they will also work with us. So what's the division of labor? Thank you, Mr. Ma. The first question was the new term of government felt that OBOR work was important, and it was very, it's a very diverse subject. It's not something that can be handled by a small office. And the new term government has placed this work under the Commerce and Economic Development Bureau. So in my opening remarks, I mentioned the overall direction, the blueprint, and some agreements we reached with the mainland. So that's the overall OBOR blueprint. When we do this work, the Bureau and departments have to work together. So we feel we need to create a directorate post. So through this arrangement, if LegCo approves, we will use the government recruitment process. So I cannot, it's hard to answer who we will appoint. I don't want people to speculate one way or the other. I just want to say that we have a standing mechanism. I don't want people to misunderstand that we will reappoint or not reappoint a certain person. This is not a consideration, and I need to clarify that. But having a proper office with continuity, I think that is appropriate, and that's why we seek LegCo support. Your second question, we have 5 ETOs on the mainland and 12 offices overseas. In our overall strategy, the commissioner and his colleagues, they will help us establish the blueprint and work plan. And there's a cooperation with the overseas ETOs. That is, some work will be given to the ETOs, but in the whole year, the focus, the ETO will have to help us draft a plan. So it's not just the ETO. We have also worked with the TDC, the Tourism Bureau, Invest Hong Kong. So we hope to have a comprehensive approach. Mr. Tan Jixun. Thank you, Chairman. The BRO and the Commissioner has a heavy workload in front of him. They have to change from being a proponent to doing actual work. The paper mentioned the OBOR 39 times. Can it become a business opportunity, as in paragraph 4E? They want to strengthen liaison between government and business professional sectors, working in concert with quasi-government, statutory bodies, chambers of commerce to promote more targeted business collaboration. I want to know, are we going to have a dollar sum figure? Will the commissioner have to meet a certain quota? And paragraph 15 says that they can be a civil servant or a non-civil servant. Well, I think ultimately it will be a non-civil servant. A lot of retired senior officials would be suitable for this post if Mr. Brian Ho Chi Ping didn't get involved in a scandal. He would be ideal for this post. So, because of the Ho Chi Ping incident, people are of the view that it is now a one graph, one bribery initiative. So they need to be aware of overseas jurisdiction laws. They cannot damage Hong Kong's reputation. So if Hong Kong business people or even people or staff in the BRO, if they were charged with money laundering or foreign corrupt practices? Will the BRO provide assistance? How can you prevent a previous a retired senior civil servant? I don't know if he had deliberately fallen foul of the law or inadvertently fallen foul of overseas law, where they contravened a foreign corrupt practice. So does this BRO have a role to prevent this sort of thing from happening?
Secretary, thank you, Mr. Chen, for your question. First, as to how to assess the performance of this postholder, as I said in my reply to Mr. Dennis Kwok, I don't think that we should set any hard target. For example, the number of business deals he clinches and so on. No, that should not be the case. On the contrary, he should be helping us to map out the overall strategy and also take part in the execution of these plans. He should liaise with the relevant government departments and other non-government bodies. And he should also plan for liaison and overseas visits, etc. So that would be a better approach to define his work. It's better than coming up with quantitative indicators. Mr. Chen referred to the whether this should be a civil servant or non-civil servant. This post covers a wide portfolio of work, and this person should liaise with the sectors on many concrete issues. A non-civil servant or a person with a business background can try to help fill the gap. So that's why we are not saying categorically whether it should be a civil servant filling the post. And so we can consider a non-civil servant. I think we should be flexible. And if a non-civil servant with the right background is found suitable, then that's good. He can fill that post. How can you familiarize with this post holder with the laws in the overseas country so that he would not be caught inadvertently by the law, or he should be, he would not breach the any anti-corruption laws? Well, I don't. Any government officer should respect the laws of the country where he is working in. Mr. Martin Liao. I think Hong Kong should take the lead in drafting the relevant legislation. I think that's the best approach. And before creating this post, the government has already strengthened the TDC's role in promoting the Belt and Road Initiative. According to the paper, the TDC has set up a dedicated team, but then how is the division of work between the TDC and BRO? And in terms of establishing this information sharing platform, will the BRO definitely cooperate with the TDC? Is not. It should not be the case, as stated in the paper, that this may include the collaboration with the Hong Kong TDC. I hope that there would not be any overlapping of work or duplication of work. Thank you, Mr. Martin Liao, for your question. This is a good question. In the past several months, we have a very close collaboration with the TDC. Let me cite an example. Last year, the TDC helped us stage the first for the first time the Belt and Road Summit. That was very much a sharing on our policies. And in September this year, there was a second summit. They focused on business promotion and business dealing, business deals discussions, and so on. So there was a participation of 53 countries and a list of 175 items were put forward for discussion by the different business partners all over the world. So the DDC does have its own advantage in terms of promoting business partnership and so on and so forth. So we have said that in the middle of this every year, in the future, there will be this high-level Belt and Road Summit to be held. We also said that through liaison with the mainland authorities, SOEs, and provinces, try to identify projects as early as possible so that these can be promoted by the TDC at an early stage. Now, responding to Mr. Martin Liao's question, starting from last month, the TDC, if I remember correctly, has set up a Belt and Road Committee with 14 of its board members as members, and they have given priority to the Belt and Road Initiative in its work. And through this special committee, they are liaising with the sector to further take forward the Belt and Road Initiative. And myself and together with the Mr. Yong, we are also taking part in the work of the committee. And we have also invited the executive director of the TDC to serve an ex officio member of the advisory committee, which has expanded as and referred to by myself earlier. We would like to do our work even better. Now, TDC may do some jobs better than we do. The TDC does have its own Belt and Road Pato. It's a very good Pato. There are successful examples. There are individual items, and there is information or country profile on 69 countries. So these are all included in the Belt and Road portal of the TDC. Mr. Christopher Zhang, I support the government's proposal of establishing PRO on creating the post of Commissioner, Deputy Commissioner, Assistant Commissioner. Now, the Belt and Road region comprises 50-odd countries, and there are so many projects going on, including infrastructure projects, energy, and financing projects. Do you have any work priorities? Which countries would you start your work? And which sectors will bring the most business opportunities for us? Thank you, Mr. Zhang, for your support in our work on Belt and Road Initiative. And the CEDB has been made the body to spearhead the initiative, and we have mapped out the relevant work directions. In the agreement signed in Beijing last week, the six sectors have been listed, one of which is financial sector of concern to Mr. Christopher Zhang. And Hong Kong will become a financing center for Belt and Road Initiative. And we support the Hong Kong MA establishing the IFFO to do work on financing. We would be also working on green financing and also establishing Hong Kong as a renminbi offshore center. We also say that Hong Kong can work together with the mainland authorities and SOEs to welcome projects which will involve the government and social capital. We will further consult the relevant sectors on how we can take forward all such works. Mr. Zhang asked about which countries we should work on first. Well, now over 100 countries are involved in the Belt and Road Initiative, and we must set our priorities. For countries which need our professional services, like financing services. These may be our possible partners. In the last item, we discussed our signing the FTA with ASEAN nations. Some of these countries need financing services from Hong Kong the most. Thailand is one example. And they are giving us more preferential treatment than those that they commit under WTO when it comes to market access. So this is one of the directions that we're heading towards. We'll continue to consult the sector. Mr. Chairman, I notice that Beijing will host a major summit in the future, and they will target the SOEs, and they will try to promote Hong Kong's financing and high-end financing services. Will we be advising them to go global using Hong Kong as a platform? Secretary, well, Mr. Zhang's suggestion is very good. This is exactly what we're going to do. So that's why in early 2018, we would focus on liaising or promoting among the SOEs Hong Kong's strengths. And I think these this is what the SOEs need. And in the finance sector, a lot of the investment projects need funds not just from one country only, but they need funding, taking out loans, financing, etc., to get the necessary capital. So Hong Kong can play a role in all these. When I talked to the SOEs, they said clearly that this is an area which Hong Kong can be of help. So that's why we need to work on this area particularly. And likewise, if the finance sector can go on visits together with us and promote Hong Kong's financing sectors, then that would be good. We hope that the representatives from the finance sector can join us in our overseas trips. It's my turn. Now, the paper says that the commissioner has an important role to play. And because he is working on a national policy, and his leadership is of utmost importance. The commissioner was originally reporting directly to the CE, but now you are proposing that the commissioner would report to the PS, Permanent Secretary. So my question is, have you considered whether the officer should be set up directly under yourself, the secretary, because it involves liaison with various bureaus, ETOs, etc. So if it is one level down, then the commission may not be able to play his role too well. And in paragraphs 11 to 15 of the paper, it is stated that the commissioner needs to have a lot of business experience in dealing with outside parties. So it says that it can be filled by either a civil servant or a non-civil servant. Would you be conducting an open recruitment exercise so that civil servants and non-civil servants are given equal treatment when they apply for the post? That's my second question. Third question. We discussed about the FTA agreement with the ASEAN, and now we are on this commissioner for BNR. And that has to do with how you're going to rationalize the different roles of the different offices. Now, if the commissioner can play this role of rationalizing the work of the different offices, and it would be better if he reports directly to you. And for the heads of several ETOs, they are of D6 posts. So that means that this commissioner is on the same level as the heads of the ETOs. So if that is the case, he may not be able to take up a leading role. He still has to get support from you yourself, the secretary, or the PS before he can conduct the work on rationalizing the work of the different offices. Going by the experience of Israel, and they employed a business person, and they adopt a set of KPIs, come up with a specific targets for the relevant offices, and that's a good approach. So would you consider that? In terms of, say, specific projects, matching projects, etc., these can be used as part of the KPI so that you can come up with concrete indicators to measure his performance. You talk about the level of seniority of the person. The new term of government thinks that this task is important. But, well, the CEDB is taking the lead and doing the coordination work here.
So that has to integrate with my bureau. The commissioner is a D6 post. The trade industry is a D6 post. Invest Hong Kong is also a D6 post. I just want an extra 5 minutes for the meeting. No objection. So, as I was saying, the posts are related, trade industry, free trade, commerce industry, Invest Hong Kong, and so they can complement each other, and the permanent secretary can coordinate this work. Just now you also mentioned that the ETOs, the highest ranks are D4 or D6. So it's also appropriate because it's not about one supervising the other, it's cooperation. So my bureau will take the initiative, but I need the work to be handled by different departments. And by having the BRO at the same level with the other departments, that will help us handle the work. You also mentioned a civil servant and non-civil servant choice. Well, we need to understand the industry needs, so I want to provide an opportunity and a chance for people with a non-civil servant background, especially in a leadership role. Would that help our work? So as the document says, we leave that question open-ended. So we will use the existing mechanism to recruit. Will it be an open recruitment? So when we create the post, if we allow civil servant and non-civil servant applicants, there is no preset condition, there's no prerequisite. I don't want to have a fixed mindset that it's going to be a civil servant post. Well, I think when you go to the establishment subcommittee, you'll face the same question. Well, we've heard members' views, and I think we all support the BRO directed posts. And of course, there were different questions. I believe similar questions will be raised in the establishment subcommittee. And I think, I hope the secretary can prepare himself for the ESC. And so we support that in principle, and we'll submit that to the ESC for further consideration. AOB, none, and that would adjourn the meeting. Thank you.